Let's go through how to draw shear force and moment diagrams. Here, I have a beam, and I've drawn both the shear force and moment diagrams for it. We're going to look at two methods of drawing these. The first is the segment method. What we do is figure out where a change occurs on the beam, so right here on this beam, a change occurs, because a force is applied here. Then we cut the beam and find the shear force and the bending moment at that location. And if there are many segments, we do the same thing, and once we figure out the shear force and moment for each segment, we plot it. The second method involves knowing the relationship between a shear force diagram and a moment diagram. So let's take a look at these two graphs here. Here are the things you should keep in mind. Notice that if the shear force is positive, the slope of our moment diagram is positive. If the shear force is negative, then the slope of our moment diagram is negative. The area under the shear force diagram gives us the moment equations, and if we take the derivative of our moment diagram, we get the shear force equations. I will go over both methods with four examples and show more relationships between them. By the end, you should have a very good idea of how to draw these diagrams, so let's get started. Let's take a look at our first example. We need to draw the shear and moment diagrams. The first step is to figure out the reactions at pin A and roller B. If we write a moment equation about point A, that eliminates the two reactions and we can directly solve for the reaction at B. Remember, B is a roller, which means it'll only have a single force upwards. Let's solve. Next, we can write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces, and that will allow us to figure out Ay. Let's solve. There is no x-reaction since there are no horizontal forces being applied to the beam. Now that we figured out the reactions of the supports, the next step is to figure out where a change on this beam occurs. We see that the 30 kN force is applied 2 meters away from point A, so that's our first segment, and then from 2 meters to 6 meters is our second segment. So we're looking at the beam from 0 meters to less than 2 meters, and then from greater than 2 meters to 6 meters. Let's draw each segment separately. First, the segment from 0 meters to 2 meters. Now instead of saying this segment is 2 meters in length, we want to represent it as a variable. In other words, x is the distance from point A. This allows us to figure out the values as a function of length instead of fixed distances. For this section, we have the reaction at A, we have the shear force, and we have a moment. The 30 kN force is not included because that's where we made the cut. So we're looking at the beam from 0 meters to less than 2 meters. This should be familiar to you from internal loadings. If you need a refresh, please check the description. Now if we write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces, we can figure out the shear force. Notice that the length of the beam didn't matter to us. Now to find the moment, we do need to consider the length of the beam. Instead of finding the moment at 2 meters, let's write it as a function of x. That way, we can figure out the moment on this section at any location between 0 meters and 2 meters. That's why we wanted to represent the length as a variable. So we're finding the moment at the edge of our beam right here, and instead of using a fixed length, we're writing it as a function of x. We have the 20 kN multiplied by a distance of x that creates a clockwise moment, so it's positive. Then we have our moment here, which is counterclockwise, so it's negative. Let's set those aside and draw the next segment, which is from greater than 2 meters to 6 meters. Now if the previous section had a length of x, and the whole beam is 6 meters, the length of this section is simply 6 minus x. That's how we will represent this length. We have the shear force, the moment, and at the other end, we have the 10 kN force. Again, the 30 kN force is not included because we are looking at the beam from greater than 2 meters to 6 meters. So remember that wherever we make a cut, we don't include the force at that cut. Now as before, we will write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces to figure out the shear force. We have the shear force and the reaction at the end. Let's solve. Next, we need to figure out the moment. Again, we want to write the moment as a function of x. So we have the moment at the beginning, and then we have the reaction times the perpendicular distance, which is 6 minus x. Let's simplify. Now we can plot our graphs. Let's start with the shear force diagram. So from 0 meters to 2 meters, we have a constant value of 20 kN. Then from 2 meters to 6 meters, we have a shear force of negative 10 kN. Now notice the large jump here. If we calculate the difference, you will get 30 kN, which is the force that's being applied at that point. This is why when we draw the segments, we don't include the force at the cut, because our equations will take care of it. Now a moment diagram. From 0 meters to 2 meters, our equation is 20x, so let's plot it. At 0 meters, we have 0, and at 2 meters, we get 40, so that's 20 times 2. Now from 2 meters to 6 meters, we use the other equation, and that's our moment diagram. You should notice some interesting things. If we take the slope of our moment diagram, that gives us the shear diagram. In other words, the derivative of our moment equations gives us the shear values. This also means that the area under the shear force graph gives us our moment equations. Also notice that when our shear force is positive, the slope of our moment diagram is positive. When our shear force is negative, the slope of our moment diagram is negative. Let's take a look at this problem involving a distributed load. So as usual, our first step is to figure out the reactions at pin A and roller B. To do so, we need to express our distributed load as a resultant force. We can do that by multiplying the load by the length, giving us 320 kN. We place this at the centroid of our distributed load, so at 4 meters. Now if we write a moment equation about point A, we can directly solve for the reaction at B. Don't forget to include the moment applied at the end of the beam. Let's solve. Now we can write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces. That allows us to figure out the reaction at A. Let's solve. Note that there isn't an X reaction at A since we have no horizontal forces affecting the beam. Now we can find the segments on the beam where changes occur. In this case, we have a distributed load from 0 meters to 8 meters. So that's one segment. The next segment is from B to C. Let's draw the first segment separately. We will say the length of this segment is X. We have the vertical reaction at A, the distributed load, the shear force, and the moment. We don't care about the reaction at B since that's where we made the cut. We're looking at the beam starting from 0 meters to less than 8 meters. We can figure out the shear force by writing an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces. Starting off, we have the vertical reaction at A, then we have the distributed load, but remember, we don't have a fixed length, so we multiply the load by the length, which in this case is x. And lastly, we have the shear force. Let's isolate for the shear force. Now to find the moment. So first, we have our moment. Next, we need to think about the moment created by the distributed load. We can find the resultant force of the distributed load by multiplying the load by the length, so that's 40 times x. Then we place the resultant force at the midpoint of our length, so that's x divided by 2. So the moment created by the distributed load is the multiplication of the 2. Remember, we aren't using a fixed length, we want it written as a function of x. Lastly, we have the reaction at A times the perpendicular distance of x. Let's isolate for the moment. Now we move on to the next segment, so that's from greater than 8 meters to 11 meters. The length of this section is the total length of the beam minus x. Again, we ignore the vertical reaction at B since that's the location of our cut. At the left end, we have the shear force and the moment. On the right side, we have the 20 kN force along with the moment applied. Let's figure out the shear force by writing an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces. We have the shear force and the force applied. Let's solve. Next, we can write a moment equation. We have our moment plus the 20 kN force times the perpendicular distance, and lastly, the moment at the end. Let's isolate for the moment. We now have all the equations we need to plot our graphs. Let's start with our shear force diagram. Let's plot our first equation, so at 0 meters, we have a shear force of 133.75 kN. Next, we plug in 8 meters and get our second point. Now for the next segment. The equation is a fixed value, so let's draw that as well. Notice the jump from here to here. If we find the difference, you will see that it's equal to the reaction at B we found earlier. Again, this is why we don't include the forces at our cuts. Our equations will take care of it. Next, we can draw the moment diagram. Let's start with the first segment, which is a parabola. That's for the segment starting from 0 meters to less than 8 meters. The x-coordinate of the vertex of the parabola can be found using this equation. Hopefully you remember this from your functions class. If we plug this value into our equation, we get the peak of the parabola, which is our maximum bending moment. Next, the second segment, which is a linear graph. Now, it's usually a good idea to write down the locations of interest. You can see where the shear force becomes zero by setting it to zero. That gives us 3.34 meters. You can also see where the moment is zero by setting the moment to zero. That gives us 6.69 meters. Notice that at the location where our shear force is zero is where the maximum bending moment occurs. And those are our answers. Now we're going to switch to a different method to draw our diagrams. Instead of cutting the member at specific locations and then considering each segment, we're going to look at the forces applied to the beam and construct our diagrams. Even with this method, we must still first figure out the support reactions on our beam. So let's start off with a moment equation about point A. That will allow us to solve for the reaction at B. Let's solve. Now an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces to find the reaction at A. Let's solve. Note that there is no x reaction at A since we don't have any horizontal forces. Now we will begin constructing our shear force diagram. Starting at x equals 0, so at the very left side, we have a force of 450 newtons straight upwards. That shear force will remain the same until we come to this point right here, which is where the 800 newton force is applied. So we subtract 800 from 450, giving us negative 350. The shear force remains the same until we get to this point. Here, another 600 newtons is subtracted from our value, giving us negative 950. This continues until we get to the very end, where the support force at B, which is 950 newtons, is added, giving us 0. Now let's draw a moment diagram. Remember that the area under the shear force diagram gives us the moment. So starting at 0, we have a moment of 0 since the area is 0. Now if we move to 1 meter, the area under the shear graph is 450 newton meters. So that's the value of our moment at 1 meter. Now it's a positive slope because our shear force is positive. So it's a linear increase towards 1 meter and the max value at this point is 450 newtons. Then we look at it from 1 meter to 2 meters. The area under the graph is 350 newton meters and that's negative, which means our moment will be decreasing. And is 450 minus the 350, giving us 100 newton meters. So right up to 2 meters, our moment is 100 newton meters, and it's a negative slope. Now at 2 meters, we have a moment applied, and that's a clockwise moment. So we add that value to our 100 newton meters. That gives us 1300 newton meters, and it's an instant jump since it's a moment directly applied at that point. Then we look from 2 meters to 3 meters. The area under the graph is 350 newton meters, and it's negative, so we subtract 350. So at 3 meters, our value is now 950 with a negative slope. Again, it's a negative slope because our shear force diagram between 2 meters and 3 meters is negative. Lastly, we look between 3 meters and 4 meters. The area under the graph is 950 newton meters. This is also negative, so we subtract that value, giving us 0 newton meters. And that is our moment diagram. Let's take a look at one last example covering applied moments, forces, and distributive forces. The first step is to figure out the reactions at the supports. To do that, we have to show the resultant force created by the distributed load. So that's the load multiplied by the length, giving us 45 kilonewtons. We place that at the centroid, so that's 1.5 meters away from B. Now we can write a moment equation about point A. This allows us to solve for the reaction at B. Next, we can write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces. Solving gives us the vertical reaction at A. Note that we got a negative value, which means the reaction is actually facing downwards. There is no x reaction at A since we have no horizontal forces. Now, we're going to draw our shear force diagram. Starting at x equals 0, we have the support reaction at A, which gives us a shear force of 14.3 kilonewtons. Note that this support reaction is facing down, so it'll be negative. Now we move forward until we get to this point. This is where our 8 kilonewton force is applied. That's also downwards, so we just add that to our current value, giving us 22.3 kilonewtons. Now we keep going forward until we get to point B, where we have a support reaction upwards. Let's add that, giving us a positive value of 45 kilonewtons. From here on, we have a distributed load. When we have a distributed load, our shear force changes with respect to the length. That means we will not have a straight line, but rather a downward slope line. It's a negative slope because our load is downwards. If we keep going to the very right edge, we have a total load of 15 times 3 meters, giving us 45 kilonewtons. It's negative since it's downwards, so adding it to our previous value of positive 45 brings us to 0. So that's the distributed load on our shear force diagram. Now we can draw our moment diagram. So remember, we're calculating the moment for the whole beam at x equals 0. So initially, we don't have a moment since we're at 0 meters and the area under the shear force diagram is 0. Then we move forward 2 meters. The area under the graph is 28.6 kilonewton meters. So our line has a negative slope since the shear force is negative and we end with a moment of 28.6 kilonewton meters. Now at that location, we have a moment that's being applied. That's a clockwise moment, so that's positive, and we add that to our value, giving us 8.6 kilonewton meters. This created a jump upwards like this. Now from 2 meters to 3 meters, the area under the shear force diagram is 14.3 kilonewton meters. That's negative since the shear force is negative. Let's add it to our current value, giving us 22.9 kilonewton meters. Next, we look at the segment from 3 meters to 5 meters. The area under the graph is 44.6 kilonewton meters. This is still negative since our shear force is negative. So let's add it to our current value, giving us 67.5 kilonewton meters. Up until now, all of our lines have been linear. Now looking at the last section, so from 5 meters to 8 meters, the area under the shear force diagram is positive. That area is the area of a triangle. So that's half times the height times the length, giving us a positive 67.5 kilonewton meters. That means at the end, the moment is zero. However, this segment is not linear. This will be parabolic and its slope will be positive because our shear force is positive. And that is our moment diagram. That should give you a good idea on how to draw shear force diagrams and moment diagrams. I hope this video helped, and if it did, please consider sharing it with your friends and classmates. They too might find it helpful. Thanks for watching and best of luck with your studies.